Good morning, everyone. Will you please take a seat, please, so we can start the program? Yes, good morning. And there will be people coming in, but let's start the program because we have a very wonderful opportunity today. It's rather historic. Today, Seattle Central and Seattle District would like to welcome to Seattle Mr. Miguel Fraga, First Secretary of the Cuban Embassy in Washington, D.C. Good morning, everyone. My name is John Martinez. I'm faculty here at Seattle Central in our Basic Studies Division. I would like to thank everyone who has helped and supported our efforts to present today's program, the Multicultural Services. And also I'd like to thank Tina Young, who is our director, our new director for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. Very significant development. Also I'd like to thank student leadership for their help and contribution, especially Samuel Chesno for leading that effort. Morning. We had a wonderful meeting. Mr. Fraga had the opportunity to sit down and exchange notes with Chancellor Wakefield and Dr. Sheila Edwards Lang here at our college. And that was so they are also very supportive. And also, I would like to thank our interpreters who are with us today from Disability Support Services here at Central. We have two. We have Amanda Alves, who will be providing ASL interpretation, and Rachel Grossman Khan, who will also be with us today. And then finally, I'd like to acknowledge the support of our faculty union, our AFT Seattle Local 1789, for helping us make today's effort possible and bringing students to meet Mr. Miguel Fraga. Presentation today is titled Imagining New Paths for U.S. and Cuba Relations. So who better else to tell us than the First Secretary of the Cuban Embassy in Washington, D.C. Please welcome Mr. Miguel Fraga.
Well, good morning. Thank you very much. This is a great opportunity for me. Thanks to all people who made possible this. It's a real privilege to be here, to be with you, to talk about Cuba, to talk about the United States, the possibilities that we have right now. I always said that we are in the best moment in the last 50 years to do Cuba and the United States. First, sorry for all this job to you. We Cubans are famous for long speeches. You know, we talk a lot. I don't going to break any record here today, but and please listen to her because I do many signs, but the correct signs are her signs. Okay. So we like to say that we are in the best moment in the last 50 years between Cuba and the United States, but we don't want to wait another 50 years to have normal relations between Cuba and the United States. Thank you. Many people believe that right now we have normal relations. And I'm going to try to explain what is the real situation right now. What is real happening between Cuba and the United States. We reestablished diplomatic relations after more than 50 years, but we don't have normal relations. And the big question is what is going to happen after November? What is going to happen with the next administration? Because everything can change, you know? Right now we have President Obama, and President Raul Castro, who wants to have better relations, they are working to have normal relations, but there are some obstacles in the middle, and I'm going to try to explain that to you this morning. And sorry for my English, probably I need to improve a little, but this is a good opportunity to practice, you know? And at the end, please do all the questions that you want, okay? So, let's start. U.S.-Cuba relations. You can see there, the Washington Memorial in Washington, D.C., and here is the Jose Marti, our national hero, memorial in Havana. You can see how similar they are. And this is because we have a lot of history together, you know? And for that reason, let's start. Well, opening questions for you. First question, what do you know about Cuba? And this is very important, because I had the opportunity to travel here in the United States, and every time I ask this question, I get different answers, but the real issue is that people don't have enough information about Cuba. When I say, what do you know about Cuba, people say, okay, you are famous because strong, because cigars, beaches. I remember one student that told me, I love Lucy, you know? I love Lucy, the joke. And I say, the only thing that you know about Cuba is I love Lucy? Oh, you missed the last 50 years. And this is true. The problem is that sometimes what you get about Cuba is the headlines. And Cuba is beyond the headlines. There is much more about Cuba. For that reason, I have the second question. Would you like to visit Cuba? Please raise your hand. Okay, wonderful. That is a lot of support. The third question is, do you consider that Cuba and the United States can have normal relations? That's so important. And the real question is, why not? What is the real reason for Cuba and the United States to not have normal relations? Number four, have you been in Cuba? How many of you? Okay. That is another problem. You know, as Americans, you can travel wherever you want. But in order to go to Cuba, you need a license. Why? Why only to Cuba? We are that big threat to the United States? So that is something that we need to change. And this is not a concession to Cuba. This is about your freedom. Why can you not go to Cuba as a tourist? Right now it's prohibited by law. I don't know if you are aware of that. And the last question, and probably this is for the end. Do you consider that Cuba receives fair treatment in the media? This is for the end. After I present all what I want to present today, probably you have more idea. If you know all this before, if you read these things in the media, and we can see that at the end. Well, let me start with this. Why the Cuban Revolution? Why in 1959 the Cuban people made a revolution? This is only Fidel, Raul, a couple guys that made the revolution. This is something about the people of Cuba. And I have this quote. I believe that there is no country in the world, including any and all the countries under colonial domination, where economic colonization, humiliation, and exploitation were worse than in Cuba, in part owing to my country's policy during the Batista regime. You know, Batista was the former president of Cuba. I approve the proclamation which Fidel Castro made in the Sierra Maestra, when he justifiably called for justice and especially yearned to write Cuba of corruption. I will even go further. To some extent, it is as though Batista was the incarnation of a number of sins on the part of the United States. Now we shall have to pay for those sins. In the model of the Batista regime, I'm in agreement with the first Cuban revolutionary. That is perfectly clear. Do you know who said that? You have any idea who said that? Well, this was in October 24, 1963, and was published in, was an interview for the New Republic, which published on December 14, 1963, and was President John F. Kennedy. Probably you don't read that every day. But this is very important, because this was the man who approved the invasion of Bay of Pigs, was the man who dealt with the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I always like to say that since to the experience of Bay of Pigs, we avoid a nuclear disaster with the Cuban Missile Crisis. And was the president who really understood the reality of Cuba. And he was working to improve the relations. Unfortunately, almost a month after that, he was assassinated in Dallas. But I bring this quote because I believe that you can find real information about why Cubans made the revolution. I always say, and this is kind of joke, but if you want to know what with Cuba before 1959, you need to see The Godfather, second part. Have you seen that movie? This is not Cuban propaganda. It was a real story. The mob was in Cuba trying to create the new Las Vegas and trying to put corruption, gamble, everything in Cuba. And Cuba made the revolution to change all that, to create a more equal society. And I'm going to try to explain this. Sometimes I speak more fast, but today I have to be, you know. So, unfortunately, since the early 60s, the US policy toward Cuba has consisted largely of isolating the island nation through a comprehensive economic sanction, including an embargo on trade and financial transactions. Everybody knows that President Eisenhower cut the diplomatic relations on January 3, 1961, 17 days before President Kennedy took office. Everybody knows about the Bay of Pigs invasion. Everybody knows about the Cuban Missile Crisis. But what after that? You know, that was in the 60s. By the way, I always use this because President Kennedy took full responsibility for the invasion of Bay of Pigs. And I like to quote your current ambassador in Japan, Carolyn Kennedy, the daughter of President Kennedy, who last year said, 52 years after the Cuban Missile Crisis, President Kennedy will be proud of what President Obama had reached out with Cuba. And this is important to try to understand why we have right now the best moment in the last 50 years. Well, this is Cuba. I try to present these facts about Cuba. And this is all from the World Bank. So you can check this online if you don't believe me. And if you don't believe me, my only advice is go to Cuba. Okay? Population, 11 million. We are smaller than Pennsylvania. We have a GDP of $77 billion. Our per capita income, according to the World Bank, is more than $6,000. Our life expectancy, 79 years old. Our birth, attended by skilled health staff, is 100%. Our mortality rate is 4 children per 1,000 live birth. Our immunizations is 99%. Some children, because religious issues, they don't want to take the vaccine. It's not mandatory. For that reason, we only have 99%, but everybody has access. Our literacy is 100%. Our population with access to improved water sources is 95%. The percent of population with access to improved sanitation facilities is 93%. This is very important because every time that people try to compare Cuba, I say it's not fair to compare Cuba with the G7 countries because we don't have the same resources. But even if you compare Cuba with the G7 countries, you can see that our numbers are very good in many areas. But if you compare Cuba with the rest of Latin America, with the rest of Africa, Asia, you're going to see how many things we are proud to show to the world. And this is not because, you know, this is because only the work that we have been done. Our two top priorities in Cuba are education and healthcare system are both for free for all the population. And right now we are changing many things in Cuba. We are giving more space to the private sector, but we are not going to privatize education or healthcare. And we try to defend society with equal opportunities for everybody. That is the idea, that is the dream and the reality. And this is very important. Our spend in education is 12.8% of our GDP. According to the World Bank in 2010, that was the highest investment in education worldwide. Our health expenditure is the 8% of our GDP in health. We only spend the 4% of our GDP into the military. And to health and education was allocated 53% of the total expenditure of 2014 budget activity. So we don't have a lot of resources, but we put the major part of those resources in education and healthcare. This is from the United Nations. According to the Human Development Index 2014, Cuba is number 44 out of 187 countries. Or you can read that in the media every day. This, I'm sorry, this is from the sport. I am a sport fan, you know? And this is from the result of Cuba in the Olympic Games. We are very proud of that. If you see the numbers are very small, but if you see the numbers before 1959, we didn't get any medals. After 1959, we are right now in number 18 worldwide. And it's expensive to have good athletes, but we are proud of those results. For example, in 1992 in Barcelona, we were number 5 with 14 gold medals at that time. And we are very proud of that, and we're trying to keep that. I love Twitter, you know? I love Twitter because you have to put all your ideas in 140 characters. So it's a challenge. And I take a lot of information from Twitter. I don't know if you're aware of this. This was from NASA. They say, happy birthday to Arnaldo Tamayo Mendez of Cuba, first Latin American and first person of African ancestry in space. And some people say, okay, but you're talking about ancient history. You're talking about the beginning of the revolution. What now? What do you have to show now? Well, the numbers are now, but also we have this. This was last year, June 30, 2015. According to the Health Organization, to the World Health Organization, Cuba is the first country in the world to receive validation for eliminating mother-to-child transmission of HIV and syphilis. Well, this is more information. I do this presentation in different scenarios, so I have to present all the information. These are our key trading partners. You can see Venezuela, you can see Canada, you can see Netherlands, China, and imports, you can see Venezuela, China, Spain, and Brazil. We are doing business with all the countries around the world. It's difficult because the embargo is there, the embargo is something real, but we are doing business. Right now, Cuba is not isolated anymore. Cuba has diplomatic relations with 191 countries, orders, and institutions. 190 of the 193 United Nations members. We have 114 foreign diplomatic missions in Cuba, and we have 122 embassies and missions abroad. You can check and compare this number with many countries. You're going to see that this is something that we are very proud of. Sometimes the Cuban embassy is a building with a flag and three people inside working hard, trying to have all the opportunities to improve the relations, but we are very proud of our foreign policy. Well, we are also proud to fulfill the Millennium Development Goals according to the United Nations. You know, that is very important, that is the result of our work. And this is something that we are very proud of. We don't only have results inside of Cuba, we try to share, we try to have cooperation with all the countries in the world. And I can say that more than 300,000 collaborators have provided service in 158 countries in the world. Right now we have more than 50,000 Cuban healthcare workers providing service in 68 nations. Everybody. Some people say, okay, you send doctors to Venezuela because the oil. And I say, why we send doctors to Haiti? Why we send 400 doctors to fight the Ebola in Africa? Was not because of the oil. What we have with Venezuela is cooperation, you know? And we have cooperation with many countries. In this case, Venezuela provides oil to Cuba with good prices. It's not only to Cuba, they provide to many countries in the Caribbean, and we have cooperation, we send the doctors, but we share our resources with all the people that need help. Since to the Yes I Can education, and this was before President Obama, by the way, since to the Yes I Can educational program, we help more than 9 million people to leave illiteracy behind in 30 different countries. More than 68,000 students from 157 countries have graduated in Cuba. Some of them are from the United States. We start a program with a religious organization in New York, and right now that We have students from almost every state, and more than 100 students are in Cuba studying medicine to come back and help the people here in the United States. It's the only thing that we ask. Well, this is from last year. This is an editorial from the New York Times, 2014, I'm sorry. Cuba's impressive role on Ebola. And they say, Cuba has a long tradition of dispatching doctors and nurses to disaster areas abroad. In the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina in 2005, the Cuban government created a quick reaction medical corps and offered to send doctors to New Orleans. The United States didn't take Havana up on that offer. They say at the time it was politics. But we offered 1,000 doctors to help when the Katrina, I don't know if you are aware of that. But after that, unfortunately, we had this earthquake in Pakistan. Pakistan asked for help, and we sent those doctors to Pakistan. And we also offered help when September 11, 2001, we offered our airports to help everybody, to have the plane that you need to send to other places. And we always offered our help, but sometimes they say it's politics, it's not real help. And I like to, this is from my Twitter account, I put this last year. This was our former president Fidel wrote when the Katrina, and you commemorate last year the 10th anniversary. And in September 19, 2005, our former president Fidel Castro wrote, "There is nothing strange about the behavior of Cuba, which did not hesitate to offer the people of the United States the immediate dispatch of experienced doctors with the essential resources needed to administer emergency care to people in mortal danger following a serious natural disaster. Also, our country was closer to the area hit by the hurricane and was in the position to send over human and material aid in a matter of hours." This is Cuba. You know, we help. We like to help. Well, the last year, come now to the reality. Everything changed. December 17, 2014. President Obama and President Raul Castro, breaking news. We are going to war for established diplomatic relations. Wow. Everybody was shocked. But I like to say, you know, the war don't come to an end after that. Nothing bad happened after that. And you can see here, we have a national newspaper in Cuba, Grama. We published both speeches, President Obama and President Raul Castro's speech, for all the people to read what they say about this. And I can't explain, I was in Cuba at the time. I cannot explain how many people was happy to see that finally, after 54 years, we had an opportunity to have normal relations with Cuba. So everybody support that in Cuba. But why is this happening? Well, I'm going to show you a lot of polls, I'm sorry for that, but I have been told that you like polls. You want to know what people said. I'm going to show you all the polls that prove, and un-American polls, by the way, that prove that the majority of Americans want better relations with Cuba. And this, I have these two from 2014. The first one is from February 2014 from the Atlantic Council that say that there is bipartisan majorities support for normalization with Cuba, with Florida leading the nation in support. So 56% of Americans and more than 60% of Floridians and Latinos favor changing the US policy toward Cuba. So this was in February, and the announcement was in December. And we have this from the Florida International University from June 2014 that said a poll finds a majority of Cuban Americans in Miami-Dade County support normalizing relations with Cuba, 68%. And an overwhelming majority, 71%, expressed the view that the embargo was not working at all or not very well. Why Florida is so important for us? Well, we have 2 million of Cuban Americans living here in the United States. 1.2 million live in Florida, according to your census. And the majority of those Cuban live in Miami-Dade County. So when we say that we're talking about the majority of the Cuban American community, we have the number to prove that, you know? And this is a real change in the last 50 years. Right now we have the support of the majority of the Cuban American community. But this was, again, before the announcement. The first poll after the announcement was a poll from the Washington Post and ABC News, and said December 2014, find a strong bipartisan support for an end to train and travel bans with Cuba. 68% support ending the trade embargo with Cuba, and 74% ending the travel ban restrictions to Cuba. We did several talks between Cuba and the United States, trying to find the grounds to reestablish the diplomatic relation. We had one round in Havana, one round in Washington, another round, and after that we reestablished the diplomatic relation. You can see both women there, they were the leading persons in both sides. Your Assistant Secretary of State, Roberta Jacobson, and our Director of the U.S. Division in Foreign Affairs in Cuba. Women is trying to find a solution that is good, you see? And this was another historic moment. This was in April in Panama, the first official meeting between the U.S. Secretary of State and the Foreign Minister of Cuba. You can see the faces, and they say, okay, they are serious. Well, that was at midnight, after a very informal meeting in the lobby hotel. But at the end, they shake hands, and nothing bad happened. And we have this historic moment, the first meeting between the President of the United States and the President of Cuba in more than 50 years. And you can see they are both laughing, they are both talking about everything, all the aspect. And we are still here, you know? Well, more polls, sorry for that. The first after these important meetings, this is one that say in April, 6 in 10 Americans support better U.S. relations with Cuba, so we can say 60%. Another poll, shows support for normalizing relations with Cuba has grown to a majority among Cuban Americans, 51 to 40%. And this is from the Univision, trying to see what the Latino population said. I'm going to read only the last sentence. 40% of Cuban American voters will be willing to support a candidate favoring normalization of relations, while only 26% will be less inclined to vote for that candidate. According to the government, we are no longer a state sponsor of terrorism. Since the 80s, Cuba was in that list. And when you analyze the real arguments, the real reason that they present to put Cuba in that list, you cannot find nothing concrete. Because we sent soldiers to Africa. Well, you need to read what President Nelson Mandela said about that. We helped to put an end to the apartheid system in Africa. We are very proud to send people to fight for it. We don't want to buy any nation. We are not there. We only help and we come back. They say because we help the liberation movement in Latin America. Well, some of those movements are right now in power as governments in Latin America. So there are different reasons. But we never commit a crime against the United States. We never commit an act of terrorism against the United States. But I found, and this is something that I want to share with you, a government that made a terrorist act against the United States and never was in the list of the state sponsor of terrorism. This is a memo that Secretary of State Schultz presented to President Reagan in the 80s. And according to this memo that now is public, and you can see the source there, you can find that memo if you want, the CIA concluded that there was convincing evidence that Chilean dictator Augusto Pinochet personally ordered his intelligence chief to carry out the murder of ex-critic Orlando Letelier. He was the former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Allende, and he was living in Washington, D.C. And if you can read the last sentence, what Secretary of State Schultz said to President Reagan was, nevertheless, this is a blatant example of a chief of state direct involvement in an act of terror, of state terrorism, one that is particularly disturbing both because it's occurred in our capital and since his government is generally considered to be friendly. I never saw Chile in the least state of exposure of terrorism. I never see an embargo, a blockade against Chile. I never saw that. And in that act, not only was killed Letelier, also an American citizen lost a life, the secretary of Letelier. So, nevertheless, we were in that list since 1982, in the list as state sponsor of terrorism. Well, this is important 2 moments. We reopened our embassy in Washington, D.C., July 2015, and you reopened your embassy in Cuba in August 2015. I like very much what Secretary Kerry said at that moment, at that ceremony. Cuba's future is for Cuban to shape. It's the only thing that we want. We want to change many things, but that is going to be the decision of the majority of the Cuban people. After that, another poll. This shows that the 73% of Americans, including 56% of Republicans, approve of renewal ties, and 72% of Americans approve of ending the trade embargo. And you can see how the number is going up between January and July. And this is very important, because we have this support, and people don't have enough information about Cuba. Imagine if we have Americans traveling freely to Cuba and can see what is the real Cuba. I'm sure that those numbers going up. Very easy, very easy. Well, another historic moment. My ambassador, Jose Ramon Cabañas, presented his credential to President Obama on September 17, 2015. For the first time since 1959, a Cuban ambassador presented credential to a US president. And I don't know why 17 is so important for us, many important things on the 17. I don't know what is going to happen next year, it's 2017, but this was very important. Another historic meeting between President Raul and President Obama in New York during the United Nations General Assembly. And I like very much what President Obama said at that opportunity. For 50 years, the United States pursued a Cuban policy that failed to improve the life of the Cuban people. We changed that. That was important. This is another poll from the Atlantic Council, and this is in Iowa, Indiana, Ohio, and Tennessee, these 4 states. And you can see 68% of support for relations between Cuba and the United States, and 70% that say that the trade ban, the travel ban, is not working, it's the wrong track. I don't have the number for Washington. Probably we need to do something here in Washington. Probably next time I can show you, but these are real evidence that prove that this is what the majority of Americans wants. And I want to be clear in this. The most important thing for me when I have the opportunity to talk with people is to see not those numbers, the real support that I see every time I go, I say, I'm from Cuba. People come and say, thank you very much. No, thanks to you. Thanks to you for all your support all these years, you know? So, well, the last year, we had 4 members of your cabinet in Cuba. We have Secretary of State, Secretary of Commerce, Secretary of Agriculture, Secretary of Transportation. By the way, the Secretary of Transportation was in Cuba 2 weeks ago. They signed an agreement to have commercial flights to Cuba for the first time. Probably Alaska Air are going to Cuba in the near future, and probably you can come to Cuba to see our country. And we received the governor of New York, the governor of Texas, Arkansas, and Virginia this year in January. We have 28 members of the House in Cuba and 17 senators. And I put plus 7 because this year we already received 7 members of the House. We are talking about everything, and this is important, because with respect, we can talk about everything, about all our difference. We are talking about environment. We are trying to find common ground to work together in that. We are neighbors. We cannot change that. We are talking about law enforcement. We are talking about mail, claims, human rights, global health. For the first time, we work together in Africa against Ebola. We provide the facilities. We provide the doctors. Probably we are going to do the same in Haiti. We are going to help Haiti, you are going to provide resources, facilities, we are going to provide the doctors. And this is only another proof that we can have normal relations and it's going to be good for everybody, you know? Not only for Cuba, not only for the United States, for many people in the world. We are talking about travel, commerce, internet and telecommunications, security of trade and travel flows. And we are talking about the Colombia Peace Talk because the Colombia Peace Talk are in Havana. We are hosting that important meeting. We are trying to find the peace in Colombia after all these years of war. This is my ambassador this year during our National Day in Washington. And I think this quote is about why we don't have normal relations with the United States yet. And he said, "In Cuba, we believe that bilateral relations with the United States will be normal only when we exercise full sovereignty on all our territory, when we are not longer under the sanctions regime, and when not a specific program are funded to alter our way of life." So this is what Cuba said about why we don't have normal relations. I'm going to explain that. I talk, and probably you read about the embargo, what we call blockade, by the way. What is the embargo? What the embargo means? I can tell you that 70% of the Cuban population don't know another reality but the embargo, because we were born after the embargo was established by the United States. And if you want to understand what the embargo means, I'm going to show you this document. This is from the State Department. This is a document from April 6, 1960. So before we said that we were socialists, because we announced to the world that we were socialists in 1961. And this document was public in 1991, so 31 years after they wrote this. But you can find this in the office of the historian of the State Department. It's online. It's fast. It's easy to check. So, point now, this was a memorandum to the Assistant Secretary of State for Inter-American Affairs in 1960. And the first point was, "The majority of Cubans support Castro. The lowest estimate I have seen is 50%. 50% is very good, by the way, but it's the lowest that he saw. There is not effective political opposition. What he proposed, what he said, we need to try to alienate internal support in Cuba. And how can we do that? Well, with economic disadvantage and hardship. And what he proposed? Well, you can read the last two sentences. And he said, we need to deny money and supplies to Cuba, to decrease monetary and real wage, to bring about hunger, desperation, and overthrow of the government. That was the idea behind the embargo. And the embargo is an economic war. For us, it's not the answer to all our problems, but it's the main obstacle for our development in Cuba. What the embargo means? Well, you have several laws here in the United States. One of those laws said, if one ship, and this is from 1992, if one ship goes to Cuba, needs to wait 180 days to come to the United States. What that means, every time that we need a ship and we are on an island, we need to bring things to Cuba, we need to pay more, and pay more for nothing. Because they say, okay, remember, I cannot go to the United States in 180 days, you have to pay for that. And that's the embargo. We cannot use the American dollar when we buy anything abroad. What that means is that we need to change our currency, and we lost money in all those changes. We don't have credits for agricultural products here in the United States because it's prohibited by law. So it's very difficult to live in this world that is so connected, to live with the embargo in place. By the way, Assistant Secretary of State for Inter-American Affairs put a yes in that document. So he approved that, and you see the embargo after that. But the embargo is no longer a problem between the United States and Cuba. It's no longer a bilateral issue. Read what the USA Today published last year. Despite improving relations between the United States and Cuba, the United Nations vote to condemn the American embargo against the communist island for the 24th year in a row. So for the last 24 years, the United Nations is asking the United States to end the embargo. So this is no longer a bilateral issue between Cuba and the United States. And read this. The General Assembly voted 191-2 to adopt the resolution with only the United States and Israel opposing it. The 191 vote total represent the most countries ever siding with Cuba, up from the previous high of 188 the last 3 years. So, Americans don't want the pardon. Cubans don't want the pardon. Cuban Americans don't want the pardon. The world don't want the pardon. Why is that? By the way, that is how much the pardon has cost to Cuba. I don't know how to say that number. It's a huge number. But that is all the damage in numbers. But you cannot put the real damage to the people in a number. But our people is suffering because of the pardon. And this is President Obama in the State of the Union this year. He said, 50 years of isolating Cuba had failed to promote democracy and set us back in Latin America. That is why we restored diplomatic relations. Applause. That's a turn tree. Okay? Opening the door to travel and commerce, positioning ourselves to improve the life of the Cuban people. Applause. So if you want to consolidate our leadership and credibility in this hemisphere, recognize that Cold War is over. Please leave the market. And this is important because we need Congress. We need Congress to change the laws that already are in place and are main obstacle to normal relations between Cuba and the United States. The next president can change everything. But in order to have a real normal relation, we need Congress. I'm going to explain that. Another important issue, Guantanamo. We don't want the base. What President Obama already said is he's going to close the prison, but he's not saying that he's going to return the base to Cuba. And you can see that the US has leased Guantanamo Bay from Cuba since 1903. The land belonged to Cuba, but the original agreement, known as the Platt Amendment, gave the United States complete jurisdiction and control over the base. For those who don't know what the Platt Amendment means, probably you learned in your school about the American-Spanish War. After that war, Cuba was under the occupation of the United States Army, and the governor of Cuba at that time said to the people who was writing the Constitution, the first Cuban Constitution, they say, okay, if you approve the Constitution without the Platt Amendment, you are not going to have a free republic. So in order to have a free republic, you have to approve this amendment in the Constitution. And we have a very difficult vote, but at the end more people say, okay, we want a republic even with the Platt Amendment. But since the Platt Amendment, now you have Guantanamo base. And after that, in 1934, another agreement gave the United States the use of Guantanamo in perpetuity. So forever, everybody asks me, when this end? Never. Because unless the United States either unilaterally abandons the base or both the United States and Cuba agree to end the lease, you are going to be there in Guantanamo. And we want that territory back. It's our land. By the way, Cuba has refused to collect the money that you pay for the base. Do you know how much you pay for the base? You have any idea about that? Let me show you. You pay $4,000 for all that land per year. Probably you pay more in taxes. Probably you as a student have more debt than $4,085 per year. And this is not about money. I want to be clear about this. This is not about $4,000 or $2 million. No. It's because we don't want a base in Cuba. And as a matter of fact, you don't need a base in the 21st century. This is something very important also. For many years you have to provide money, taxpayer money, for suppression and destabilization in Cuba. You don't send money to Cuba to help in education, to help to build houses, to help. No. It's only to create, it's only to try to promote democracy and the overthrow of the real government in Cuba. And according to the Congressional Research Service, Between fiscal year 96 and fiscal year 2014, Congress appropriated some $264 million in funding for Cuban democracy efforts. That is an important reason why some people don't want to have normal relations in Cuba, between Cuba and the United States, because some people are living with this money. This is a business. You know, some people is having this money, and it's a way of life for some people in Cuba that say that they are political dissidents, but are traveling around the world with that money. And this is a bill that you have right now in Congress. According to the Congresswoman Betty McCollum, she put this bill in the HR 570 and say, stop wasting taxpayer money on Cuba Broadcasting Act. You have right now a TV station, a radio station, and a website with only one idea, to broadcast propaganda to Cuba. And you haven't spent $700 million in the last 30 years. Okay, sure. Okay. I need to almost to finish, but this is information that probably you don't have. So I'm going fast. This is the best bill that we have right now in Congress, S-299. It's about freedom to travel to Cuba. Again, it's not a concession to Cuba. It's about your freedom. We have right now 47 senators that are behind that bill. And we have bills about free trade to Cuba. By the way, both senators in Washington support the freedom to travel to Cuba. But in the House, it's not the same situation. In the House, we only have one member of the House that supports freedom to travel to Cuba. I don't know why. Well, this is something important. You are losing opportunities in Cuba. We buy 78% of our food abroad. We are talking about $2 billion. But because we don't have credit here, it's more easy for us to buy things in other places and not here in the United States. And we are talking about $2 billion, as I mentioned. We only buy $300 million here in the United States because we don't have credit. That is something that you are losing. We have opportunities in the health sector. We have products that probably can help Americans. You are not able to travel to Cuba if you want to have medical opportunities there. So these are real things that you are losing because we don't have normal relations, and these are things that are good for both sides. We have a lung cancer vaccine that help people, and you cannot have it here because the embargo. Well, this is something that we have in the House of the Cuban Working Group. This is the last poll. For the first time, more Americans like Cuba, 54%. That is something important. And this is the real news. President Obama is saying, I'm going to Cuba in March. March 21, March 22. And this was the official response of Cuba. President of the United States, we will treat it with all respect and considerations during his visit to Cuba. It's the first visit of the American president since 1928. This is what the president can do, what the president cannot do. For example, he cannot authorize you to go as a tourist to Cuba. We need to change the law if we want that. You have the final question. I hope now you have more information to answer all that. This is a commercial. If you want more information, please follow this Twitter account. My ambassador, myself, all the information there, our embassy. This is the poll. The poll was very important. And this is the golden rule. Do unto others as you will have them to do unto you. And for the end, this is the end. Change is the law of life. And those who look only to the past or present are certain to miss the future. And if our dreams of yesterday are today's reality, our dream of today will be tomorrow's realities, and thus be the same for all people of the world if we are able to dream of a better future together. So, for those who wants to cut the relations, they belong to the past and they are going to miss the future. For those who want to create real opportunities and want to dream about the future, we can start today. Thank you very much. I'm so sorry.
And I would just like to make two announcements before you leave. Tomorrow there will be a conference at Seattle University featuring Mr. Miguel Fraga with workshops on how to discuss these questions and participate in the change that we need in order to normalize our relations with Cuba. Announcement number two is that our AFK local here in Seattle, our youth teachers union, is proud to support our event. So we'd like to present Mr. Fraga with our union teacher. That some of you have to leave, but we can take a few questions here before. We have two volunteers with microphones. Let's see, Professor Ana over here, Gabby over here. So please raise your hand if you have a question and wait for the microphone before asking your question. And just we can take two or three. Let's see what we can do.
Sorry for all the time. Yes. I believe we have one question there. Okay, yes.
Now that we have established a relationship, what is the plan of the Cuban government?
I believe that it's not on.
Now that you've established relationship with the U.S., what is the plan of the Cuban government to defend itself against U.S. imperialism? That's one question. And the second one is, what will be your economic model moving forward from now on? Capitalism, socialism?
The second question is?
What will be your model, your economic model moving forward?
Okay. Well, about this, we have a relation with all the countries in the world. So we are not afraid to have normal relations with the United States. We are going to change what the majority of the people in Cuba wants to change. But we have relations with capitalism countries, and we don't change our way of life for that. And about the second question, we are trying to improve our economic modeling, and we are trying to give more space for the private sector. But we are not going to privatize education or health in Cuba, and we are not going to create more difference. That is the big challenge that we have right now. We are trying to keep a society with equal opportunities for everybody. And the main goal is to see the end of the embargo. If we see the end of the embargo, that is going to improve the life of the Cuban people very easy. And again, we have relations with many countries in the world. And so far, somebody asked me, are you ready for the invasion of the Americans to Cuba? And they say, it's going to be better than the Bay of Pig invasion, for sure. And after that, they say, okay, about your culture. We are not going to change our culture because the Americans go to Cuba. By the way, we see a lot of American movies in Cuba, and I always say here that Seattle is very famous in Cuba because everybody likes Grey's Anatomy. And we see before I came here, my mom told me, oh, you should go to Seattle, take a picture in the hospital. I said, Mom, the hospital doesn't exist, you know? Thank you. Who else?
Well, I was kind of piggybacking off of that, just because, like, what is the feeling of the people of Cuba? I mean, let's face it, the last time we had a relation, it didn't go too well, and the U.S. kind of exploited it. So, what's the feeling of the people of Cuba, but also, what's the feeling of Congress actually amending some of these laws and the embargo against Cuba? You know, there's a lot of behind scenes going on, and people making money off of the embargo, so.
Well, about the feeling of the Cuban people, I can tell you that if you go to Cuba, despite the 50 years, you're not going to see that Cuban hates America. Cuba don't hate America.
I'm not sure.
We share a lot of history, a lot of things, for example, baseball. We love baseball. If you go to Cuba, everybody's going to ask you, how is the Mariners doing in the baseball right now? So the feeling is that we have an opportunity. With respect, we can deal with all our differences. And we are not going to try to change America for the reason we are asking the same. Don't change us. You know, don't ask to change us. And about the second question, I believe that I only presented the information. You know, it's up to you to see what what is going to happen. It's your Congress, it's not our Congress. We don't know why we don't have more support there. We don't know why we have still those laws in place if the majority of people don't want that. If you do a survey among people, everybody wants to go to Cuba. And there is no real excuse to say that you need a license to go to Cuba, you know? Thank you. Thank you for your question. We have a person here.
Hello. Wondering, I'm not sure if you're allowed, I'm not sure if you're to what degree you can answer this question, but we have some Americans who are in Cuba as refugees or that are seeking asylum, and we're wondering what is Cuba going to do to protect them? I'm thinking of specifically people like Asada Shakur. I'm wondering if you can speak to that. Like, what can Cuba do to protect?
I think our position in that is pretty clear. We granted asylum to those persons because there are real reasons for that. Our position in that has not changed. Nevertheless, we are ready to talk because it's not only about this issue. We have difference in many issues, and we are ready to hear what are the position of the United States. We are going to defend our position again. This is not about concessions, you know. This is about that we can have a normal diplomatic relation with respect, as you have relation with all the countries in the world, you know. And we have difference, but we are not going to change our principles. We are not going to surrender. We are not going to say, okay, no. We wait 50 years, you know. We can wait another. We don't want, but if we need to wait, again, the main issue in this is we are going to defend what the majority of the Cuban people wants. Thank you. All the questions that you want.
Yes, but we have a presentation. Another presentation.
No, just a gesture. So Jill Wakefield, our chancellor, wanted to make sure we received this gift.
Thank you.
From our winery in South Sierra.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you very much. We're going to check that with the people in the embassy, no?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Hello. Before I start, ask my question, I just want to say I totally agree with normalizing the relationship between U.S. and Cuba. But I guess my question I want to ask is, right now we have a presidential election and we have two Cuban-Americans, Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio. And both of them, actually, they're both Cuban-Americans, but they want to scale back normalization with Cuba. And I just want to know what your thoughts are on that, given that, you know, they are of Cuban origin, but they don't want to help, you know, the Cuban people because of the Castro regime.
Well, it's an interesting question. I don't going to endorse any candidate today. No. What we say is we respect all the positions. We cannot be in agreement with somebody that defend the blockade, because the blockade hurt our people. And what we can say is that, who are you representing? You are not representing the majority of the people here in the United States if you say that you want to cut the relation with Cuba. So this is, again, we have a lot of respect for the political situation here. It's not something that we are going to try to change. It's up to you. We don't want to discuss these things. We only say that we are ready to talk with everybody, with respect, and for the good of both peoples. That is our position, and it's very clear in this. Again, when we talk about the normalizations, we have the support of the majority here in the United States and in Cuba. Thank you. Please.
Yes, I want to thank you very much for coming. I'm a member of the Socialist Workers Party here in Seattle. And we think that what you presented is very important because people need to find out what the Cuban Revolution is. Capitalism is not doing any good for working people in this country, and we here will have to emulate what you did in your revolution, and that's our job. My question is, could you just say a word about the Cuban Five, they're being freed, and what they... the reception they received in Cuba, and what they're doing today to further the revolution?
Well, I was trying to find probably you remember the slide with the grandma, and you see both speeches, President Obama and President, but the real news was the 5-hour in Cuba. So we celebrate that. We were very happy to see that moment. The 5 in Cuba was, and now we have Gerardo with his daughter, and you put that in a movie and people is going to say, this is fiction, you know, this is not real, real thing. But we are very happy we are very proud to have the 5 in Cuba, and they are proud of all the support, not only from the Cuban people, from all of you that for many years asked for their freedom. So they are heroes in the real life right now, and they were in prison for so many years, and they don't do anything wrong. They only try to avoid terrorist attack against Cuba. So they are real heroes, and we are very proud to have them in Cuba. For many years, people told us that is not going to happen. Gerardo is going to die here. You are not going to see that, and we see the December 17, and that only proves that victory is possible. That if you fight and you keep fighting, you can win. Thank you very much.
But actually, it's not much of a question, it's more of a comment. I wanted to thank you as a representative of the Cuban government. I'm from Puerto Rico, and many people don't know, but the Cuban government has been a stalwart advocate within the UN for promoting Puerto Rican sovereignty. And they're pushing back for it. Recently, I heard an interview with a person who was a political prisoner, a Puerto Rican political prisoner, Don Javier Cancel Miranda. And really, he's free in Puerto Rico because of the efforts of the Cuban government in an exchange of political prisoners. And so I just wanted to thank you as a representative of your government for that, and also to try to remind everybody we still do have many political prisoners. One of them recently is Oscar Lopez Rivera, who has been petitioned to be out of prison for a while now, and is still in prison. So thank you very much. Again, not a question, more of a comment. Muchas gracias.
Gracias. Thank you. Depends on what you want, you know? Yes, please.
I'm just wondering, as of now, at this time, is it possible for someone with an American citizenship to study in Cuba? Or someone with a permanent residency, if not a citizenship?
Well, yes, right now it's possible if you have the license to go there. From your government, you can go there and study. We have this scholarship for a student who wants to study medicine in Cuba. I can provide the contact here in the United States if you want, because we have this opportunity. It's a small opportunity. We don't have enough slots for everybody to go there.
I actually know about the organization, but the thing is, you have to be an American citizen to do that. I'm a permanent resident, but I'm not a citizen.
Well, I can give you my card, and we can be in contact for that, okay? I don't have the answer because I'm not in charge of that interchange, okay? But
great, thank you.
My pleasure.
And we have one more important announcement.
Okay, John has already announced about the day school, the day conference tomorrow at Seattle University between 10 and 4, and I and a colleague are handing out flyers about that. But I also wanted to say something about the Cuban Five, the question was asked. We have another event tonight. It's mentioned a little bit on the flyer. At El Centro de la Raza Community Center, between 6:30 and 9:30, we've got the opening of an exhibit, photography exhibit, about the return of the Cuban Five to Cuba. Miguel will be speaking at that. He will be speaking, not this presentation, a different presentation, specifically about the Cuban Five. So if you want to learn more about their case, and why they were such heroes in Cuba, I encourage you to come to El Centro de la Raza tonight between 6:30 and 9:30, and the details are on the flyer. Thank you.
Well, I have to say goodbye. I only want to say thanks to all of you for being here. And she told me, thank you.